Welcome again. Right now we're at Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Loyalty and obedience to God. You see, right now we're fixing up to just fly. I mean, you know, once we hit Romans chapter 6, 7, 8, and we're when we get there, we're going to be flying. This is like going down the runway right now, okay? Verse 1, being therefore justified by faith. One thing I need to say about this word faith, okay? In the Greek, it's the pistis, it's called. And this means faith, but it can also be translated faithfulness. So you see, that word pistis is not just about just some kind of a mental ascension as to something that's true or something that you believe is true, but it means faithfulness. It's talking about loyalty and obedience to God, continuous loyalty and obedience to God. Being therefore justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we also have our access by faith into this grace in which we stand. We rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only this, but we also rejoice in our sufferings. Now you see this from time to time throughout the scriptures, how the apostles, how the disciples say, you know, we rejoice in our sufferings. Now, this is completely opposite to the way the world talks. It's like, we rejoice in our comforts, in our blessings, in our riches, and in our pleasure. That's not what it says here. So we got to be able to rejoice in sufferings, knowing that suffering produces perseverance. And don't a lot of people need some perseverance? A lot of people, they don't have much patience, they don't have much endurance, they don't have much perseverance. But if you take on suffering head on and you take it on with a very good attitude, it can give you some good perseverance. And perseverance, proven character, and proven character, hope. And hope doesn't disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. For while we were yet weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will hardly die for a righteous man, yet perhaps for a good person someone would even dare to die. But God commends his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Paul says to the saints in Rome, let's not lose our perspective here. Who is speaking? Who's the author? And who's the audience? Paul is writing to the saints in Rome. And he says, while we, he's talking about himself and the people that he originally wrote this letter to. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. What you need to realize here is these people, Paul included, and the rest of them that he's writing to, they were all still sinners while Jesus hung on the cross. When Jesus was on the cross, and he was dying, and he breathed his last breath, Paul was still a sinner. And so were these saints in Rome. And that's what Paul meant by, while we were still sinners, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. What you need to understand is we cannot truly, accurately say this today. And I know a lot of Christians say this today. You know, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. No, excuse me. You weren't living in 33 AD, okay? And you weren't a sinner in 33 AD. So while you were still sinning, well, Christ died almost 2,000 years before you were a sinner. So us today cannot truly, accurately say, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. No. But we can say, if it applies to us, Christ died for us almost 2,000 years ago. Verse 9, much more then, being now justified by his blood, we will be saved from God's wrath through him. See, by far, most people They think the blood is some kind of magical thing that they just, you know, oh, I apply the blood, or I believe in the blood of Jesus. Oh, it's by his blood. They have absolutely no clue what they're talking about. They don't even know how the thing works, okay? Paul here was a Jew, and he was speaking to the saints in Rome, and, you know, at least some of them were Jews too. They knew how the system worked. They knew the sacrificial system. Ask any Orthodox, knowledgeable Jewish rabbi today, how did the sacrificial system work? When you were convicted of some kind of a sin, you are to take your sin sacrifice to the temple. While that sacrifice is being slaughtered, you are to watch that sacrifice. You are to connect with that sacrifice. You are to use that as a prophetic action, saying, when this particular animal dies, my sin dies with it. When this particular animal is sacrificed, I am sacrificed with it. When its blood is being poured out, that blood is its life. The life that is poured out of that animal, I connect to that life and I say, that life is my selfish, sinful life that's being poured out. The whole idea, the whole purpose of sin sacrifices back in those days was so that people could look at that and connect with it, and it would be a catalyst of repentance for them. So that when they walk away, they can say, wow, man, I have been sacrificed with that lamb. I have been sacrificed with that animal. My sinful life is gone. And we're going to see this in the next chapter, Romans chapter 6. It is going to be awesome. I mean, this is world-shaking stuff, okay? It is going to be awesome. The whole idea of the sacrificial system and how it worked, when the priest took the fat of that offering and put it on the altar and burnt the fat, that fat was representative of your lust or your passion to sin. Paul knew what he was talking about when he said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. Where did he get that from? That wasn't just some nice little kind of neat little thing he pulled out of the hat. I mean, no, he knew this is how the sacrificial system worked. This is how it worked with animals. When the animal was sacrificed, you are to identify with that animal. Likewise, when Jesus was crucified, you were to identify with Jesus. And that's why Paul said in Galatians chapter 5, verse 24, those who belong to Christ, those who belong to Messiah have, okay, past tense, have crucified their sinful nature with all of its passions and its desires, its lusts. Where did he get that from? Well, that's just basic Jewish understanding of how the sacrificial system worked. That is how we are justified. That's how we are justified by faith. When we look upon Jesus by faith on the cross, when he died, we can say, I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. We can say, as it says in Galatians chapter 5, we have crucified our sinful nature, our passions, our sinful lusts. We have crucified them by faith. That is how we are justified. Because God, through his grace, gave us power to repent and to be free from the bondage of sin. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, will we be saved by his life. Not only so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. As I said in the beginning, this chapter is ramping up for a biggie. I'm telling you, we are on the runway. And once we hit Romans chapter 6 and onward, I'm telling you, we're flying, okay? In the next session, we will talk about the reign of sin and the reign of Yeshua. Until then, seek God with all your heart. And if you do, you will find him. Call upon him. And he will show you great and mighty things. You know, it's exciting. It's like, you know, a little child when your father shows you awesome things. it is glorious. Love you guys.